Are you ready?
Yes, I am.
Okay, I have a question for you. You ready?
Yes.
¿Quién los dejó entrar a mi casa? Welcome to yet another Drag Race Review podcast. I'm your host, Terry Blas.
And I am Chicho Quintero.
And this is the J word, your home for all things Drag Race Mexico. Should I explain?
Yes, of course. Please, where are you? Where in the world is Terry San Diego?
How appropriate considering Global All-Stars.
Yes.
I am currently in a hotel room in downtown Boise, Idaho. I am in my hometown, about to do a convention. So yeah, if you are in the Boise area, I mean, by the time this goes up, it'll be too late, but come see me at the Boise Concords Festival. So yeah, this is my lovely hotel room. This is a downtown Boise, everyone. Thrilling, right?
Princess, welcome to
Welcome to
Genovia.
Genovia, right? But yeah, this is my Boise Comic Arts Festival shirt, super cute with Mickey on it. And pues aquí estamos, right?
Yes.
How are you?
I'm great. I'm great. I'm excited. I have some stuff to say about Global All
Wait,
Stars.
how excited are you?
Me siento muy
There
excited.
you go. Okay, you want to do housekeeping and do a little Global All Stars?
Yes, of course.
All right,
So,
housekeeping. Oh, you know what?
housekeeping.
Literally, I heard three times this morning.
Housekeeping.
Yeah.
Okay,
Okay.
so we watched Global All Stars last night. Well, you just saw it,
I
but
just watched it like 15
yes,
minutes
exactly.
ago.
But it was okay. I want to say it was a good, even great episode because I'm starting to get into everyone there, and I love like the runways and the looks and whatever. But I tweeted something. I tweeted like one of those video reactions with "Ramen Holiday" by Nicki Minaj,
Oh, okay.
with some Korean program like they were just like doing, sports and gymnastics and whatever.
Of course.
Because the editing on this episode was wild. Like things were going like 100,000 miles per hour. Like those runways were like 2 seconds long.
Oh, yeah, they
Like
were pretty quick.
it was and it was just like the okay, 1 second. ¿Qué te sucede? She's just lying in her back, like barking to the roof. Like what's your problem? Okay, anyway.
We have a very special guest judge this
Yes.
week.
Hello. So yeah, it was I felt like it was like messy and all over the place, and like it didn't feel like the same rhythm that usually a Drag Race episode has. So I'm gonna check the credits, but I'm questioning if it's not the same editor as a usual season or all-star season of Drag Race.
Oh,
That
maybe.
maybe they got somebody different that is kind of like copying how it's supposed to go, but they're not letting it breathe. And somebody was like, why are the episodes shorter? But they're not literally all of them shorter, just this one, but the previous two were kind of longer. So it's their different lengths. So what is
It
going
seems,
on, you know?
it does seem weird though to have a ball episode where everyone's going to show three looks and have it be shorter. So that's a
Exactly.
little weird, but yeah.
I already don't love when they do balls like in the first three or four episodes, which they sometimes
Yeah.
do, because it's like, girl, that's too much. Like, let some queens go home before you do a ball, you know?
Sure. I mean, how many queens are there right now? Like what,
There were
11 or something?
it was with 10. They
Or
have 10.
10? Okay,
So
that's
that we
still too
got,
many. Maybe
yes.
do like with six or seven left.
Exactly. Because 30 looks is, I think it's too much.
It's a lot.
Anyway, so
Well, let's talk about our Galavaro. How did she do?
yes, well, we got a little bit more of this character arc that they're trying to make with her, with how she's basically a sex bomb, because she goes to Rue during the walkthrough with her nipples out. She has this shirt that has like a slit, on the chest, but the
Like
way
a
that he,
big hand.
yes, like a beacon. But the way that he kind of like yes, like the way that he's kind of wearing it, just his nipples are completely out. And so the first thing that RuPaul says is like, you're gonna poke somebody's eye out with those. But that's actually where I started noticing the weird editing, because I know there's 10 girls, but we're only getting one girl in each group talking about their looks.
Yeah.
And sometimes we have had episodes where we get almost all of them talking about their looks. So it's like how fast?
Well, I don't know that that's necessarily true, because Tessa Testicle talked about how she did have a fashion degree, and then they asked Alyssa what she was going to do. So there were, but maybe that's because they had that interaction.
But that's in different groups. You're talking about I know.
They were right next to each other.
Yeah, you're right. But yeah, it was still crazy. But yes, just we got Gala's nipples, and then she was safe. I feel like the looks were great, but obviously it wasn't nothing to write home about, especially the one she made. So the one she made in the workroom, she comes out, and I was like, oh, that looks great. She takes off the whatever kind of like jacket or something that she had. And she just reveals to this like plain bodysuit, gray bodysuit. And I'm like, oh, okay, she's gonna be safe. she's not getting in the club.
I wasn't super impressed with her looks. I thought they were fine. Obviously, they're safe. My favorite moment in the whole episode is when she's talking to Kitty and she's like, but do you think you can be sexy? Because you're not sexy. You're like cutesy. Cute. It's And it's funny because I feel like she knows exactly what she's saying, but she's trying to pass it off as like a language barrier.
But also Kitty just turns to the camera and goes like, what did he just say?
Yeah, she's literally like.
Also, I feel like they're slowly painting her as, if not a villain, at least somebody who's just not going to shut up about stuff. Because she told the Swedish queen at the beginning, like, that lip sync, you won, but that lip sync was trash. Yeah. She said trash. So he's like, okay. Yeah.
Well, I think for the runway, whatever, my favorite looks were Pythia, obviously. Mm. The one that she made was incredible. And I love the idea of the first look with the cameras in the hair, because get like, oh, yeah, this is a weird lady who runs the spy thing, as opposed to some of the other ones, like, I'm sorry about it, but like Queen Kong or whatever. It's like, well, you're just a lady in leopard print. You could be anyone. You don't look like you run a spy agency.
I felt, because, okay, we know that back in the day with Drag Race, it was like, hey, here are the prompts, and queens would go to their literal closet or to some friend's closet and be like, oh, this can fit the team, blah, 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 blah. And I feel like some queens did that with this specific prompt, because some of these looks were like, you're reaching a little bit too far with this one.
I agree with that.
Yeah.
It's sort of along the same lines, but I my favorite looks actually were Miranda LeBrow's.
Yes.
And they said, sure, the second one didn't really fit the thing, whatever, but like it could have. Like, it just depends on how you look at it, I guess.
I understand.
Her looks are incredible, and I think she's amazing.
I understand if they put her in the bottom because of the second look. But the look she made there was incredible.
Oh yeah.
And they were and Jamal was like, oh, I didn't love it. And I was like, no, it was incredible. And I love that there were like a couple of references to Carmen Sandiego at some point in the show.
They lived for Alyssa though, and I was like, her looks are just okay.
Yeah, that's when it just starts to like, oh, okay.
I'm like, okay, this is clearly the Alyssa meet and greet.
Yes. But I did love the fact that Tessa is just becoming like a. She's. I didn't see her. I didn't watch her season, but she's a freaking goblin out of control, and she's just like creating chaos wherever she goes. And I love that when she said like, "Oh, I'm not gonna lip sync." I know that she was probably delusional or something, but in deep down, I wanna believe that she was like, "Girl, I'm bringing the entertainment, so I'm safe for at least a couple more episodes."
Sure, maybe.
So,
Yep. Well, let's move on to this thesis you wanted to chat about.
Okay, so here in Mexico, and apparently, sometimes in some other countries, but here in Mexico, you have to write a thesis in order to graduate from whatever major you chose. And they're usually, just like a big chunky research paper, right? Where you present like a hypothesis and you do your research and your results and your conclusion, and that's it. But it's usually, you know, a taxing project for some
process,
people.
Yeah.
There's literally people, it's a common joke here in Mexico that there's literally people who finish their education like years ago, but they haven't graduated because they haven't finished their thesis.
Oh, wow.
Yes, it's wild, but it's very common here in Mexico. So sometimes there's jokes going around that, you know, there are some jokey theses out there, you know, with crazy hypotheses or crazy research subjects. But this time around, a couple of theses went viral, specifically one.
Wait, from where?
From Mexico. Okay, so this is what I'm going to tell you. The first one is a thesis that proposes that basically the title is Sailor Moon Made Me Gay. And then the subtitle is like how Sailor Moon during its original run on Mexican TV affected the lives of millennial gay men.
Okay.
And it's a thesis that to earn a master's degree in humanistic studies from the Tec de Monterrey, which is a very famous private school here in Mexico. There's another thesis that I want to talk about, but first I want to tell you about this one because you're going to get mad very early in the morning. I'm sorry. But this went viral for all the wrong reasons because people are coming for this thesis. And they're saying that it's too jokey, that it's not a serious subject, that why would you spend all this money studying just to graduate with that, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm like, bitch, who asked you? And it's like, it's their thesis. They can do whatever they want. And it's actually a pretty interesting subject. You know, how culture affects the development of gay children that eventually become gay men.
Yeah, like, I mean, I went to art school, so that's the keen of like, oh, you're graduating and spending all that money to do this project? Okay. So like, that doesn't, you know, but who cares? If you don't like it, you don't like it. Move on.
I guess the asterisk here would be that that this person who did this thesis, they had a grant from CONACYT that is kind of like a body here in Mexico that gives out grants, but that comes from our taxes. So basically people were like, why are they using our taxes to fund somebody's education that is going to end up in a Sailor Moon thesis? I still think that it's completely valid because it's like,
why is that not a valid subject? Like if I were to write a thesis about, okay, so not to, but my thesis was about the Shakespeare play, The Tempest, because it's my favorite play. And not just because it's a Shakespeare thing, but I wanted to do a character design project. And that play specifically is full of types. So there's like a wizard, a witch, a prince, a princess, a spirit, a monster. And
it's
I was like,
D&D
so
campaign. Then we can,
yeah, so we can, but we can analyze what these types mean in popular culture. So my thesis referenced, you know, The Wizard of Oz, Harry Potter, Lost, Gilligan's Island. So just because you're doing a thesis about Sailor Moon, you're talking about millennials, millennial culture, pop culture, television, like who cares? Like
the fact that we had so much free anime available to us as a generation because on open TV, not cable, they were just, you know, releasing anime left and right during the 90s. So
yeah, right there, you're talking about, without even knowing it, you know, cultural import from Japan into a different country. So
anyway, so
híjole.
Yes. So they're having an issue. And you asked me like why, and I was like, it's a mix of misogyny and homophobia, basically. You
know? Sure. Yeah,
because of course, because if they were like, oh, Dragon Ball affected a generation of straight men, nobody would bat an eye, you know?
Right.
Anyway, so the other thesis that went a little bit viral, like a couple of days after this one, is one that basically reads, creating celebrities on Mexican reality competition drag shows like La Más Draga and Drag Race Mexico. And it's one, a thesis.
They're not referencing like Wendy from like Casa de los Famosos. Is that Casa de los Famosos?
But Wendy's not a drag queen.
Oh, no, I thought you just said making celebrities out of reality show competition people.
No, from like specifically from drag shows.
Okay.
Like
okay,
La
okay.
Mas Draga and
gotcha. Yeah.
Okay. So it's to get a master's degree in cultural studies, which, you know, makes a lot of sense, at the Colegio de la Frontera Norte, which is a college in Tijuana. So yeah, that also went kind of semi-viral because, you know, the fans are obviously like, yes, queen, like, that's great. Like, we're going to read it, blah, blah, blah. But obviously we're going to get as well a little bit of backlash of like, well, nobody wants to read that, blah, blah. But it's like, girl, it's just like literally cultural studies. Like, that's culture, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway.
So can you read these theses?
The Sailor Moon one is online. The one with La Mas Draga, not yet.
Is it just in Spanish?
Yes.
Okay. Because I'd love to send it to a few people, but I don't think they speak Spanish.
Yeah.
Well, once it's translated into English, I mean, I'll read it, but once it's translated into English, let me know so I can send it to other people.
Have you ever made it on a thesis, like as an artist reference?
Have I ever made it into a thesis?
Uh-huh.
Oh, I don't know. How am I supposed to know?
You Googled yourself.
Oh, I don't want to do that.
Because I have.
Well.
I made it on a thesis once. I think a couple of them actually. Whenever they reference like gay cinema in Mexico or whatever, I'm just like, they just mentioned me like yeah, Velociraptor by Chichi Quintero, blah blah blah. It's one of them, you know, like one of the movies that is out there. And I'm like always like, oh, okay, thank you, you know, like you know.
Yeah. The last thing before we get, I don't know if you saw this, the last thing before we get into the actual episode that I want to mention is something I saw this morning that makes me so friggin' happy. Because she's Latina, I have to mention it.
And she's a former Drag Race judge, so of course.
Of course. So that has to do a little bit with what, right? So let me move this a second. Nope. Okay. So this morning I woke up to a clip of her on the Stephen Colbert show, the late night, whatever show that he does. And he's doing that show live from Chicago right now because the DNC is in Chicago, Democratic National Convention, blah, blah, blah. So Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, after all the balloons dropped, she ran over to the show so that she could be interviewed. And he asked her, you know, what's happening right now with the current Democratic nominee? Like, this is sort of a historic thing. And how does she feel about it? And she starts telling the story where she says, you know, when I was nine, did you see this?
Yeah.
Oh, that when she was nine, she used to watch a lot of Star Trek with her dad, and she watched Voyager, and how he wanted her to see that because of a woman in leadership and Captain Janeway and everything. And so that, I mean, that thrilled me because I was like, not only is she a Drag Race guest judge and does she love Drag Race, but now I find out she's a Star Trek fan. Like, I can't with this, it's too good. So I tweet, did you see my tweet? So I tweet, I photoshopped really quick a picture of her in a captain's uniform and then tweeted about it saying like, oh, like, you know, basically what I just said, like, this is so great. And then I asked a question about like the question everybody always asks about Voyager, which is like a very controversial episode, but it's cute. If you want to see it, go check out my my Twitter.
Before we continue to the episode, I want to dedicate this episode to the memory of SPHEN, one half of the penguin couple from Australia. Remember SPHEN and Magic, because SPHEN just passed away. And and the story, I mean, I don't know if there's video, I don't want to see it, but the story goes that Magic, his partner, when they presented the body of SPHEN to him, because they needed Magic to realize that he was gone, he apparently started singing mournfully, and the whole penguin group at the aquarium sang along with him. And that is just fucking heartbreaking. And I just
feel like
at some point somebody's going to put that in a movie, and I don't want to watch it. Because, yeah, anyway. Rest in peace, Sven. And thank you for being so gay. So, yeah. And for being a great parent of two healthy penguins. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Okay. Well, Let's try to brighten it up with a mirror message.
Yes.
Speaking of brightening things up, that mirror message says, hoy el cielo se llena de estrellas y ustedes son parte de él. Then it says something I don't want to say because we hear it 10,000 times in this episode and I'm sick of it. Postdata, beso de seis, las amo. So what does this say, Nacho, in English?
So this says, I didn't write it down, so I'm just going to wing it. It says, today, the sky is full of stars and you are part of it. Unique cual. P.S. Six way kiss. I love you. So, yeah.
All right. So this is an interesting episode because it's sort of expected, right? We always get to a makeover episode in at this point in the season, but we never really know who they're going to make over or, you know, kind of what they're going to do. So this episode starts with each of them getting messages, not just from like a friend or a family member, but from like multiple people. And that's kind of cool. So they each get a message. They're all very emotional. You know, the one thing I want to mention about these is that Horacio is a little sad because hers is the only message without her without the parents in it. That made me sad because I was like, how can you not love Horacio? Like, that's your kid and you don't like, come on. Like, it's not to say they don't love them.
But it's not even that. It's like, whatever you feel about your kid being gay or doing drag, he's at the top of the kind of like success of Mexican drag right now. Like, he's like being a singer and he's at The Voice or American Idol. Like, he's like doing something that will change, that has already changed his life forever. So just get your fucking homophobic thoughts out of it and just congratulate him, you know?
Well, that's what I don't understand, is that I think a lot of this comes from like shame, right?
Yes.
But are you telling me that now you don't feel shame that you're the only parents who don't show up in a video to support their child?
And also, like, we have gotten on Drag Race US so many family moments that are like, oh my God, like, my parents are obviously not going to send me a message. And then they are, because they understand that it's a big deal. Whatever you think about the career that they chose, it's a big deal. So, but, you know, his sister was on one of those videos. And I love the moment when the sister goes like, you know, grandma didn't want to be like on camera, but like, she's here and she supports you.
But she's here and she, yeah, that's exactly. Cute. It's funny because I can understand that. Like, you know, like, oh, I don't know. I don't want to be on camera. So they do something kind of funny, like a little trick. A what?
Truco.
Truco. where they're announcing what they're going to do for this challenge. And then they're like, oh, wait, something's going on. Everybody stop production. Oh, my mic. I don't know. Like, Lolita is like, oh, I think maybe my mic's not working. I usually think rainbow flag stuff is like the colors are so jarring, weird, but I love this outfit that she's wearing. It actually looked really cool.
Yes. The thing with that is like, the colors themselves look great in a flag, not on clothes.
Yeah. But because half of it was like the, you know, the other part of the flag that's like been added to it recently, I thought it looked kind of cool and it was made with like strings or something. Anyway, so they stop production and then like it shows the production crew. I was like, what's happening here? There's, you know, obviously we know that they're going to bring them in, but then like this, the seeds kind of part and then like their family members walk in or their friends or whoever, you know, most of them, if not all of them, had been in those videos. Mm-hmm. So it was really sweet. I think we can, we'll get to it, let's just do it right now. Because if we can, I think what I'd like to do real quick is say that like, Horacio's person was like their best friend. Mm. Lexa's person was their sister who was also gay. Mm. Jenary's was a friend of theirs that they made when they moved. Eva's is a friend that they've known since they were like 8 years old or something, right? Or 12 or something, I don't know, it's really cute. And then Elektra's is it's like her drag daughter, but not necessarily like a drag queen. So like someone in her chosen family who's like her daughter. Her cat's sibling is what she called them. So they're gonna have to make these people over. as a member of their drag family. But, and I don't, I'm sure they've done this before, maybe, but I can't off the top of my head think of it. They gave them a specific runway theme that they had to adhere to along with this makeover.
I'm trying to think.
I'm sure they've done it before. Okay. But yeah, like either way, this one is like,
Okay, something similar-ish would be, for example, the All Stars 1 girl group challenge slash makeover, because they had to be part of the same girl group.
Okay.
When it was celebrities, when it was Vanessa Williams' daughter and Kelly Osbourne.
Remember? Right. Yeah,
but
yeah,
also,
yeah.
Now that I'm saying it, the latest one in All Stars 9, it was also the firemen. It was also specifically they had to be a girl group because they were going to perform.
Right. That's
yeah.
right.
But
yeah.
That's
so
like
sometimes
the
they do, but
yeah, yeah.
This is like luchadores, right? Like,
but exoticos. So do you know about them?
I of course do.
Okay,
of
okay, okay,
course
okay.
I do. But for those
okay,
who
so,
don't, real quick.
Well, in lucha libre in Mexico, in wrestling, we have, of course, our rudos that are kind of the equivalent to the heels, and our técnicos that are the equivalent of the, what is the opposite of the heel? The hero?
The villain? I don't know.
No. The heel is a villain, and the other one.
Oh.
Okay, let's just call them heroes. but yeah, the técnicos are the good guys, and the rudos are the bad guys, and
okay.
And then we also have exóticos. In this crazy, it's just, okay, Mexican culture is so wild. Because how on earth are you going to be so misogynistic, so homophobic, so transphobic, when your culture is so rich in gay stuff and women's stuff, all of this?
Do we need to talk about the multi-billion dollar industry of boys love romance television shows in Thailand and Korea, but the fact that Thailand just got gay marriage?
Thank you.
Like,
exactly.
Come on.
It's a girl, like, okay, pick a struggle. It's like,
yeah.
you cannot have, like, Juan Gabriel cannot be one of the demigods of Mexican culture, and then
yeah.
you also be a homophobic. Like, it doesn't make
it's
sense.
Just...
But anyway, in Lucha Libre, the most macho of macho sports in the most macho country in the world, there's this group of luchadores that are flamboyant and extravagant and openly gay. And there have been, there is not a new thing, there have been them for decades. And they put on a show with glitter and heels and everything while they're fighting. And that's like super common, and like people love them, and like they have, followers that are not gay. Like straight
so
people.
So who's the famoso that Gael just played in a
Casandro,
movie?
Casandro.
That's right.
So like straight people who follow Lucha Libre, they have like, oh, this is my favorite heel, this is my favorite hero, and like this is my favorite exotico. It's like, but then they will turn around and be homophobic. It's crazy. But yeah, the whole subject was the theme, the runway theme was exoticos. So yeah.
Yeah, it's a great idea.
Yeah,
So we don't really get any workroom stuff. We don't see, I mean, we see them a little bit putting them in makeup, right? Like once they're kind of done, and we do get a little bit of a tragic story. That's very sad.
I want to say something. No, like,
yeah.
Okay, and we have talked about this. Because we don't get almost any workroom stuff, chamba cuarto stuff, throughout the season, it was a little bit better than on season one, but it's still not on the levels of what we get in Drag Race US and all their
friends. I know, we went from nothing to crumbs.
No, but the thing is, like, because we don't get enough, all these moments, emotional moments on this episode, felt a little bit out of nowhere. Not because of the intensity, but because it's like, I'm not used as a Drag Race Mexico audience member
to see these kinds of scenes
or to know anything super personal about the people on the show. So it's almost like, I mean, that's great, and like I'm not happy for you, but like I'm happy that you have this moment and whatever. But it's a little bit too much, just all of the sudden, you know. But yeah,
yeah,
that very tragic story.
Tragic story. Yeah. I don't really think really want to get into it. It's too
Not
sad.
Really. Yeah.
But all our love to Jenary.
Yes.
Great. So let's talk about the guest judge.
I'm sorry. We are very smart drag race fans that can differentiate between what happens on a TV show and a queen's life and their work outside the show.
Yes.
And we never go like, oh, we hate her because she's terrible and blah, blah, blah. But
no,
it's kind of crazy that we're like, oh, Jenary, we love you, like, blah, blah, blah. But we have given her 1,000 churpias.
Listen.
I'm sure that you're a great queen outside of the show. Yes.
You and I both know and have both experienced queens on the show who have been heinous. And then in person, they're the sweetest, nicest, kindest, most talented,
And the opposite.
And vice versa. Yes. So we know that it's a TV show. We know that, like, so for instance, the magic or black magic of television, where Jenary had amazing outfits for this challenge, but they didn't arrive on time. So all we see is terrible outfits for the challenge. You know, and that was what she had to use.
And somebody, somebody who is not like on TikTok all the time and looking at the queen stories and blah, blah, blah won't find out that that's what happened.
Yeah.
No?
It reminds me of Pheromone in that interview talking about how in the Lady Gaga runway, she was wearing that long coat. And then Gaga was like, so here's my advice to you. Why didn't you remove the coat for a reveal? It could have been this great. And all you see is Farrah going, oh yeah, I wanted to. And Gaga going, why didn't you? And then it cuts and you find out that production was like, do not remove your coat. If you remove your coat, your mic's going to fall. You can't remove your coat. Don't remove your coat. It's like, I'd have let my mic fall, bitch. I'd have been like, guess what? I'm not going to talk. I'm on the runway. I'm not going to talk.
Not even that. It's like, I can fucking tape it, whatever you want. It's like, people
I would have been
fucking
like,
naked on the
body,
runway.
Bitch.
Come on.
Like,
yes, exactly.
So we can differentiate between television and reality.
I mean, speaking of Pheromone, the fact that they all did the talent show, they always do the talent show twice, and they chose the take where she falls.
Right, exactly.
Anyway.
The other thing that happens in the workroom that made me really sad, I started crying, was Leexa talking to her sister about coming out.
Yes.
And that it was really hard for her. Their dad went nuts, you know, things were really difficult. Leexa says, that must have been really painful for you. And Leexa's sister says, like, yes, but I mean, it's a weird translation, but she says, like, yes, but I'm happy to have gone through it if it means that it made things easier for you.
Yes.
It's like it's so full of like love and
because Leexa has always seemed to me, and especially now that we saw the whole family and everything, he has always seemed to me as this gay kid, this late millennial gay kid that is one of those kids that almost got like a coming out party from their family. Because he's a theater kid. So it's basically like, yes, we know, you know? I feel like she probably didn't have like a lot of struggles at the beginning of coming out and everything, but you never know like what happened before that. So to actually see that, yes, you probably had like an easier time, but it was because somebody else before you had a tough time. So yeah, I mean, I feel like we always want to be that person for somebody else, you know, like in a workplace or in our families. Like we always want to be like, hey, like I'm making this as normal as possible, so that if somebody else comes after me, like they're gonna have it easier, you know?
Yeah. Yep.
Anyway,
so this guest judge.
I mean, I don't know her, as Mariah would say, but like he's a famous Mexican fashion designer. And the great thing about this is that we get, if you don't know him, you get a little glimpse of his work because Taiga and Lolita are wearing his outfits. So yeah.
Yeah, I like that. I thought it was pretty cool.
Yeah, yeah.
And of course, they look great. So
I love,
you know,
I love the Lolita's dress of many vaginas. So yeah,
right. How do you want to talk about this main challenge?
I mean, we could go like
it's essentially a runway.
Yes,
challenge.
Yes, it is.
So
yes,
let's do that.
Okay. So first up, we have Leexa Fox and Sissy Fox, they have capes that we are not seeing in this photo, but they have capes at the beginning when they're doing the show. And Cece, you know, does a little bit of a fucking, oh god, I should have researched the vocabulary before, but like
she picks her up.
Oh god, fucking phrasal verbs, man. She picks Leexa up and so yeah. I feel like the performance on the runway was great, and I actually really, really like these looks. Like, I feel like these are some of my favorite looks tonight, and I love that. And I'm not saying this just because she's a curvaceous cis woman, but she, the Sissy Fox, really reminded me of Alexis 3XL. More so on the face, you know,
in the eyes,
yes, exactly. And I feel
I can see that.
The attitude, because you know, like she was walking like very like almost like manly in a way, and so the contrast between that and the fact that she's all made up kind of like gave me that vibe, and I also love
it was a nice like combination. I guess.
Also love that they're, is it them that they turn around and the capes say the future is non-binary?
I believe so. Yeah.
Okay, if it's not, I'm gonna put it wherever it goes. But the funny thing about that is that because they have half of the sentence in one body and the other half in the other body.
Oh yeah,
it reminded me of those memes where people don't know how to read a sign, and so
and it's like it turns into like a demonic spell.
I found a couple of them. But one of the more famous ones is the one that goes, in one side, you matter, and on the other side, don't give up. But you can read it as, you don't matter, give up. And so the funnier thing about this is that this was put in a way that it makes sense both ways. Because it could be, the future is non-binary, or the future is not. No, wait, no. The future is non-binary, or the... God. It's I still got it. Let me write it down because el futuro es no binario. El futuro. Okay. It's just I had to write it down in Spanish so that it could make sense. Because it said el futuro no. And then on this side it says es binario. And so it could read as the future is non-binary or the future not is binary, which in Spanish it makes sense on both ways. El futuro no es binario, or el futuro es no binario.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I got it.
All right, but I really like these outfits. I think that they're probably some of the most unique. Don't say it. But let's move on.
Yes. Anyway, next up is Horacio Potasio and Rodrigo Te Digo, which is
I love that name.
Perfect drag name, because it's like, it's so the good. Same structure as Horacio Potasio.
Yeah, I think it's so good.
So now that I'm seeing their wigs, I am reminded that I loved Leexa's and Sissy's wigs, that I felt that they were great luchadores wigs. These wigs are, you know, not bad, but like I just reminded me that I like the other ones better. I love, it's crazy because I love half of these outfits. I love everything that is vinyl and like in color. I just, the black part just feels like a literal dancing leotard with
imagine
nothing.
If the black part had been stoned.
Exactly. Literally.
I don't really like these.
They're not great, but the performance was good.
I was worried for her.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. But anyway. You know, also the makeup is pretty good. They okay.
Yeah.
Something weird happened. We have always talked about how the makeover challenge on regular Drag Race is always like, I wonder what they're gonna be looking for this time because they always change it. And
it's, yeah.
And this time they were going on and on about it's not about the outfits. It's not about the outfits. It's about everything else. It's not about the outfits. But then whoever was in the bottom was because of the outfits. So what?
Right, I told you it's tailored
exactly
for them to be able to say whatever they want.
Yeah. Okay.
It's not about the outfits, but welcome this week's guest judge, fashion designer.
Next up is Jenary Bloom and Manola Bloom.
And Mistress Isabel Brooks.
Oh my god. And once again, it's not about the body ari ari. It's literally about the wing, the eye. Like that's what's giving us mistress, you know?
Yeah.
I'm going to say...
That's what I mean. The wig and the makeup, it's mistress.
We know that in the prompts on both Drag Race and La Más Draga, they do get a prompt that says explicitly two of these because it could be for a makeup. And I'm going to say this. Jenary brought one outfit and she split it into two. And I just realized that by looking at the picture. If you look at the picture, the corset goes with the skirt and they just split it. And the problem with that is not that part, but the fact that once again, the black part feels like undergarments and not like drag.
Yes. Yeah, I think you're 100% right with that. I mean, she did a good job with being like, okay, there's two gloves. We're each going to wear one. The wigs are obviously like very prepared. So she does a good job with trying to accessorize it and make it like work. But you're right. Like it was obviously made to like be one outfit.
Yeah.
I'm just going to say this. She probably brought two outfits. But because you don't know who they're gonna bring,
but
not always gonna.
I mean, it got Gigi Good in trouble. But what Gigi Good did back in the day was that she brought bulky outfits so that they could fit anybody. So okay, maybe don't do that so explicitly, but like try to do something that you can, like it's easier to take something in than to make something bigger.
So she could have taken those. Gigi could have taken those in or belted them or something to make it look like they were then tailored to the outside
of
the body.
So do bring something large for you, larger than you, and then just take it in for you. Like,
right.
Anyway, also like the wigs.
I don't know. Like they were mad at Gigi for that, but I thought it was smart.
Yeah, I love the wigs, but not for Lucha Libre. Anyway, so next up is Eva Blonde and La Pálida Blonde. And we have talked about how La Pálida is like coming down from your high. That's kind of like how we call it in Mexico, you know?
That's great. So it works good for the name.
Exactly. So I really, 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 really love this. When have we seen this connected braids before? I feel like
I don't remember,
besides Shangela and Alexis Mateo being twins, remember?
Oh, the twin bot things.
But
yeah.
But I feel like we have seen it after, but okay, we don't remember, but I love it. They're gonna mention two things that I want to explain here. One of them is these are braids, not chorizos. So this is one of my favorite internet things of all time. I cannot call it a meme because I feel like it's an illustration that somebody did and it just became a meme. But it's an illustration, literally stick figures, of somebody and then a girl with like yellowish, reddish braids, right? And this person is telling them, oh my God, I love your braids. And the girl with the braids is saying, they're not braids, they're chorizos. It's like Don Hurstfeld levels of not making any sense. but being so fucking hilarious. And it's been going on for decades. Like, I remember it from, like, high school, literally. Like, no son, no son trenzas, son chorizos.
Son chorizos.
So they're basically saying the opposite. These are trenzas, not chorizos.
That's funny.
But yeah, I loved it. I think it's, again, it's simple. It's a luchador outfit, but it is embellished enough and detailed enough that it looks better than what some other queens did. And it's also a homage to Las Hermanas Vampiro. Las Hermanas Vampiro is a drag troupe, a drag cabaret troupe that is what La Supermana used to be a part of back in the day. And also another queen who used to be a part of the Las Hermanas Vampiro is La Super Perra, the Super Bitch, that passed away a few years ago, and it was like a big deal because these are the four mothers of queerness in Mexico, you know, especially especially queer art and queer kind of like not mainstream, because they were never like fully mainstream, but the idea of just putting on shows and like entertaining and educating people and just like being out there and like doing these things that were harder to see back in the day than today, you know. Today there's literally a homage to them on a TV show that is seen around the world. So it's kind of like that. It's a very beautiful homage. And they acknowledged it, like, because of the wings and everything. They go like, oh, Las Hermanas Vampiro, which is like the vampire sisters, basically. And but yeah, I really love this outfit.
Well, now it also makes sense that Ava was saying she wasn't just blowing smoke up La Supermana's ass when she was on the show.
No,
she was
saying,
I'm such a huge fan of yours and, you know, that you did a lot for me.
I mean, we have talked about how, like, Supermana is literally a big deal for many, many people.
I like that the guest judge also referenced Priscilla, because these are very Priscilla Queen of the Desert. So I commend Ava for doing something that has multiple references to it. That's really cool. And I do want to shout out real quick, when Ava turns her queen around in the chair, the makeup is so incredible because there's these like lights. It was gorgeous.
Thank you for reminding me.
I was gagged.
I had never seen those in my life. I don't know if they are common or not. They are gaggy. Like, my God. Like, because we see that they're LEDs, that they're connected to something under the wig cap. And obviously, now that you put everything on, you don't see the connections. But when we see them in the workroom, we see that there's like a cable. It's freaking gaggy. Like, I cannot wait for some queen in the US to do them and for us to know, oh, you saw them in Drag Race Mexico, bitch. You totally.
Yeah, it's really cool.
So
I love it.
Next up is Elektra Vandergilt, and let me read this because it's long, Madame Marthy Vandergilt. Okay, good for you. Okay, connecting to the idea that Eva was literally doing a homage to Las Hermanas Vampiro, Oscar said once again, after Elektra opens up her wings, Oscar goes, Las Hermanas Vampiro. And it's like, okay, no? Because Elektra is literally doing a literal gothy, vampire-y look, but not explicit homage to Las Hermanas Vampiro.
Right.
One. And two, you just said that. Like, it's like, it's almost like if Michelle had said twice on the same episode, like, vampire, I don't even know her, you know, like something like that.
Right.
And it's just like, oh my God. And I don't know why they let it in. They could have just cut that comment, but whatever. What I have to say about these looks is, it's always hard on Drag Race when they have to make over cis women, because especially cis women who don't drag, who are just like people who go to because you run the risk of just making them look pretty but not drag, okay?
Yeah.
Which is why, for example, Alexa Fox's sister, I went like, oh, she's giving me Alexis, because the face was the kind of drag that Alexis 3XL does, where you don't know if she sees, if she's not, if because it's a character, you know?
Her lips are super dark and way, way exaggerated. In this picture of Elektra and her queen, you can see, even in this picture, how it's not elaborate enough to make her look like a drag queen. The wig should have been twice as big. She should have had a cape or something. Like, you have to play with the proportions. Maybe even give her insane hips.
They
like
were
something.
Right. They were right when they were like, oh, you threw your partner under the bus because you look better, because the wings should have gone to her.
Oh, yeah.
At least.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that one, the choker could have gone to her. And so, like the purple choker that Elektra has. Like, my point is that the Elektra's daughter here looks like just a cute goth girl who put on a bodysuit for a photo shoot for her goth album or something. She's not giving drag.
Yeah. It's interesting what we were just talking about how they kind of tailor these challenges, especially this challenge, to you know, so they can say whatever they want. Because they easily could have been like, which I don't think they would have done here, because duh. But they easily could have been like, well, Ava, it's just like too matchy-matchy. It's just like the same exact thing. You guys are wearing the same exact thing. So it's not giving me like family member. It's giving me like clone. They could have said that. And here they could have been like, oh, so, you know, you're not wearing the exact same thing. So, you know, but you're like complimenting each other. Give me a break. I agree with what you said, that she outshined her queen definitely and didn't make her queen look like enough like a queen.
I feel like once you put them all together side by side, you go like, okay, Jenary is clearly one of the bottoms, because everybody's looks, whatever you think about them, they're polished and great, and Jenary's looks like put hastily together out of something else, right? Yeah. And then you have four left and you go like, okay, everybody looks draggy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And everybody looks like exaggerated and over the top. And I feel like even Elektra herself looks like so like demure compared to everybody else. So in a way, like it makes sense to me, the bottom placement, because the other bottom placement could have been Horacio, for the outfits not being exaggerated enough or like, you know, fierce enough. But
what really,
the wings and the makeup and the performance. So
that's it. Is I firmly believe that the wig and makeup on Horacio's person, not the outfit, the wig, the makeup, and the performance that they loved, they were like, oh, you could be on next season or whatever. That to me, then they're like, oh, drag queen.
Exactly.
This one, exactly what you just said, I think is 100% right. I love Elektra's outfit, but that's just her outfit. She didn't do the challenge.
Yes.
Right? Yes. Do you know? So it's funny, because when you were saying like vampire, I don't even know her, right? My brain in English went to Vampyra. I don't even know. Do you know who Vampyra is?
I know, but I wanted to say, I didn't deliver the joke correctly, because I know that it has to have a her sound so that it makes sense. Okay.
That's why I said Vampyra.
Anyway, so Chida and Churpia. I'm going to go first.
Yes, please.
And welcome back, girl. I thought you were a goner. My Chida of the week is Leexa Fox and Sissy Fox.
Yay. Oh, wow.
And my Churpia of the week. My Churpia of the week. Okay. Once again, boring. No. Crafty, not great. Trumps, boring. So, my Churpia of the week is Elektra and what's her name, Vandergaard. Yes.
Okay.
Just because at least there was some draggy elements on Genaris. So,
yeah. That's It's going to be difficult for me. My chida of the week is Ava Blunt.
Okay.
Mostly because of the lights.
No, yes, of course.
And because I think it's impressive to have like those double references. That's really good. My churpia of the week is really difficult because, like we said, Elektra didn't really do draggy enough for her person. Jenary's thing was one outfit that she split in two and didn't really commit to. And then the wig doesn't say, you know. So I don't know. I almost want to like double churpia, but I don't think that. Are you saying Jenary?
Don't know. Just do Oscar.
Just do Oscar. Oh. No. Because. No,
it's okay.
I never like his makeup, ever. But I actually like what he was wearing last week.
Yeah, well.
So fine, he gets a little pass for me this week. I'm just going to say...
Heart, follow your heart.
Okay, I'm going to say my churpia is Jenary.
Okay.
Because I'm excited for Halloween, and I like that aesthetic, the electric age.
Of course! No, of course, yeah.
We now get to the tops and the bottoms, but the way that they announce the tops is interesting this week because they know that if they make the top, they're in the finale. So who's on the top this week?
On the top, we have Eva, Horacio, and Leexa. Horacio, feel like it was kind of in between, but yeah.
Who won the week?
What?
Who won the week? Who won?
Eva Blunt, yes.
That's right. I think is good for her because she'd been wanting to win again so bad.
Yes.
Okay. And then who's in the bottom?
In the bottom, we have clearly Jenary and Elektra. And yeah.
Well, that means that the two of them have to lip sync.
Yes.
Tell me who the lip sync is, or what the lip sync song is, who it's by, and then ask me if I'm familiar with this.
Okay, so the lip sync this week is... It's Azúcar Amargo, Delirio y Pecado.
We're going to get demonetized. We're going to get demonetized.
Sorpresas llegas, me ves así.
We're not monetized.
Anyway, it's Azúcar Amargo, I say, which is a great song. And it basically raised a whole generation of gays. And do you know this?
I don't know anything about Faye.
Yes.
But I'm very familiar with this music video.
Okay.
I saw it when I was living in Mexico. Or when I was in Mexico. I don't know. Just saw it forever ago. And
she's like in a factory, kind of Janet Jackson in factory.
Oh, very much so. But also, in my mind, when I was younger, I was like, oh, this is the Mexican take on me. Because there's a drawings of guys in this music video that come to life, right? And in a very like sketchy kind of way, just like the Take On Me video, which at first I was, let me back up. I've always remembered this music video because it begins with what I think is the most dramatic and hilarious thing I've ever seen on film. She's drawing. And then the point of her like charcoal or her pencil like breaks. And then it cuts to a close-up of a tear.
Oh, my God.
Like, coming down her face. And I was like, oh, my God. So whenever that's a great little gif of, like, something not dramatic happens. And then you're like, so good. Then like, the factory.
Me at any inconvenience.
Yes. go rewatch this video. You're going to be like, oh, my God. So then the boys and the drawings, whatever. But then it gets to... like an outside fire escape with fire on it, but also rain, but also dancers, and also choreo. It was too much for my little gay brain. So in this lip sync, when they start doing the dance moves, I lost it.
Yes. So anyway, I really like this lip sync, but I feel like it's a lip sync that... the best parts of it could have been a little bit just amped up a little bit. Because Jenary was being very funny and very cunty with some of the things she did. but just she could have just turned it a little bit, you know, higher, a little bit, you know, because it felt like, for example, the dog walking. So Elektra starts to walk on all fours, all sexy. And Jenary sees the moment and seizes it because she then puts her arm out as if she was dog walking Elektra.
It's incredible.
Perfect. And somebody tweeted that it reminded them of
Peppermint.
Peppermint, basically blasting Cynthia out of the stage. And I feel like it could have exaggerated it a little bit more, you know? It was just a little bit too demure for what it was supposed to be. And
too cutesy.
Yes, exactly.
I'm sick of it already. Sorry.
I know, but the moment that I knew that this creator was basically financing her transition with
it. Oh, amazing. Of course. I love that for her.
Just go for it. Like, yes. So, yeah, like I said, the lip sync was, you know, good enough, sufficient.
Yeah.
I was going to tell you that Margaretia read the lip sync from last episode, Unique versus Jenary. She read it for Field on a show because she said, like, oh, I love that the queens from season one were back. And also, the lip syncs from season one are back.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
And they were just like, girl, yeah, you're right. Just for the last lip sync, this one was pretty good. Anyway, so.
Yeah.
So. Elektra goes home.
Let's. Yeah. She gets eliminated. How do you feel about that?
I wanted to say that you know how fans are. And some people tweeted like, it's so unfair how they treated her on the show and now they eliminate her. And I just want to know, what do you mean by that? Because Elektra was treated very well throughout this show.
Yeah. Like, she
had one win and then a bunch of tops. And it was like, yeah. She was always like, the judges always loved her. They always got what she wanted to say. They always praised her fashion. Like,
she had a lot of confessional moments. She had a lot of screen time.
Her run is pretty good. She just didn't make it to the end. The way that I saw it was a little bit different because I tweeted, like, first they got rid of Garcon, which we all thought that she was gonna go far at least. Then they got rid of Luna Lanzmann after two wins. And now they got rid of Elektra. Like, they are not playing around. For me, like, because it's a freaking TV show and nobody's career is gonna end after this. But for me, it's just like they're making a gaggy season of Drag Race. And that's great.
Yeah.
And Elektra, at the end of the day, was a fan favorite on La Más Draga. It's a fan favorite now. She's gonna be fine, you know?
Like, yeah, come on.
Whatever, yeah.
So she literally says, like, fifth out is not a bad place to be. That's Katya, that's Ben de la Creme.
And she's right.
Wasn't Alyssa also fifth?
Yes.
So, there you go.
Yeah.
Well. What are your final thoughts about this episode? I want to know what your final thoughts are, but then also, like, what you, I guess, who you think will win versus who you want to win.
Okay. So my last thoughts and prayers are that my top four is... Shut up. So the funny thing that happened this episode is that I have been wrong 2 weeks in a row. I said, Horacio is living in the Rose Challenge, and she won.
Mm.
And I said, Leexa Fox is living in the Makeover Challenge, and she was in the top. So it's like, I just, if you want to know what's going to happen on Drag Race, ask me my opinion, and then the opposite.
Sure.
Yes. So I'm Team Horacio. I have been Team Horacio from like 3 or 4 or 5 episodes ago, when I jump ship from Team Leexa. And I'm not going back to Team Leexa just because she did okay this week.
We're not going back.
I'm still on Team Horacio. And but if you ask me, who do you think will win? Horacio is not going to win.
Oh.
Not going to win.
Why do you say that?
I feel like it's Eva versus Jenary. It will depend.
Huh.
It will depend on, you know, we will find out at the beginning of the episode how they are sort of like pushing, if they're going to push for a girl who had a almost perfect run throughout the season and who had like a great package. I wanted to say, like, I feel like Eva's is my favorite package this season, you know? Like, I feel like she never had like a wonky outfit except for the one that she made that we didn't like, the plushy skirt. But she made that, you know? Other than that, like, she had a fantastic run. And, you know, she wasn't hilarious when she had to be, but, like, I feel like she could be a very worthy winner of Drag Race. But Jenary, if they start pushing her as not the underdog because she has three wins, but sort of like a success story of, like, you know, you've gone through so much and you haven't been able to transition with your family, but you have three wins and you have some wonky fashion, but you're so talented at performing. Like, I feel like that could be a nice story for a winner, you know?
Sure.
So, yeah,
I would think, how do I put this? It would be amazing if Horacio won. That would be kind of crazy. Because I think it's unexpected. But I think Eva might win. I don't know why. I just think she might win. Maybe because, like you said in a previous episode, because Christian won the first season, they might have more of a fashion-y queen win this season. So I can see that happening.
Or a younger, inexperienced one.
Right.
Can I say the controversial yet brave that I just realized?
Of course.
What if, shut up. What if they don't want a La Más Draga winner? So, what if immediately Eva and Jenna and Leexa are out of the question? Because they were on La Más Draga. So what if it's between Horacio and Jenary so that they could crown somebody who was not on La Más Draga? Or, even more evil, what if they want a La Más Draga winner so they could be like, see, we crowned them and you didn't. Like, it could...
It could go either way.
Yes, exactly. But yeah, I feel like right now, if I had to... I feel like it's Jenary. I'm going to say Jenary right now with Eva being like really close behind.
So tune in 2 weeks when Eva wins, because we know that what you just said.
Exactly.
Well, let's talk about something else. Okay. So why don't we talk about art.
I didn't see any on the phone.
Well, there's something in there now.
Oh, okay. Cool.
There's one piece. That is tangentially related to Drag Race,
okay,
which is not a new piece, but it's new to me because I'd never seen it before, from our querido Gibran Vargas.
Yes.
And it is something he did of, like, potential Fortnite characters. And one of them is a pretty amazing Burita Burona.
Yes.
So just wanted to show that. Anyway, that's the only piece of art this week.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, well, Chucho, why don't you tell the people where to find you?
I was going to tell the people that we're going to be off next week.
Because of?
The reunion.
That's right.
Yes.
Okay,
because,
so...
Let's face it, the reunions are never going to be fun as long as they shoot them right after the shooting, which is what happens when you have to shoot in freaking Colombia. Anyway, so we're not going to, but, you know, we're going to upload some TikToks and you can watch us on TikTok. And you can find me on TikTok and Instagram and Letterboxd as Chucho_QMP and on Twitter as Chucho_Q.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Terry Blass, on TikTok at Terry_Blass, on my website, terryblass.com, and this weekend at the Boise Comic Arts Festival.
I'm not going to upload them these before Sunday.
I realize that.
Yes.
All right. Thank you for joining us. Until next time, and as always, respeta tu cultura, maricón.